Christopher Deane works in sales and transport and in business logistics. He lives in Auckland, New Zealand. He has traveled extensively, including to countries which have since become fraught by civil strife, such as Afghanistan. It has been bearing witness to dramatic changes in parts of the world once safe enough to travel across and now bitterly divided that animates the suspicion he feels towards government. We will be examining those power structures that daily condition our lives with an emphasis on resolving the problems at their source. Welcome back to the English Hour on ANN Television. It's a joy to have you with us. Thank you for joining us today. Our guest is Christopher Deane. Chris Deane, and it really is a privilege to have a good friend and a New Zealander, really, on our program. The first New Zealander we've interviewed. And we've got three interesting subjects for discussion. We're going to talk about the root causes of conflict and getting back to basics, dealing with conflict and problems without necessarily going to war.
At the source.
The second issue is the economic drivers, the economic motives that drive wars and drive conflict forward, and we're going to look at that whole issue.
Follow the money,
absolutely. And the third, the third is, where are we? We're looking at the media. And we're looking at the media, the whole question of how the media influences public affairs and where we're going, and whether it's part of the solution or part of the problem.
The aggregation of the media in fewer and fewer hands.
Right, absolutely. So three tough subjects. We'll start with the causes, looking at the back to basics, the very basic causes of the problem. We need to look at resolving the problems at the source of conflict. We need investment in civil society, infrastructure, health services, and social provisions that might reduce conflict by leading individuals to envision a wider array of options for their lives and to lose interest in violent social agitation. Ideological radicalism, or at least the willingness to act on it, results from desperation. The Arab Spring and its ramifications are a prime example of the consequences of such desperation. So, Christopher, the issue of the causes of how we deal with the problem, how we deal with the root cause of a problem, and here we're talking really about conflict, aren't we?
Do you deal with it, or do you stop it happening in the first place?
Right.
And if you stop it happening in the first place, you don't have to deal with it afterwards. Education, running water, electricity, childcare, women's rights. If people are educated, why would they want conflict?
True. But that's the theory. And yet, in practice, I mean, even Western, relatively sophisticated, educated nations, I mean, look at the Baltic conflict. They became tribal all over again. And Serbians were attacking Bosnians who had been brothers a few years ago. I mean, before the...
Were they whipped up, or was it a grassroots?
I
think they were whipped up by people, men generally, who wanted more power and control.
So that makes sense. But then you get things like you get a whole range of different drivers for conflict, don't you? Look at some we can see coming, like, for instance, Egypt and Ethiopia. Mm-hmm. Egypt and Ethiopia are moving towards war because Ethiopia is building a massive dam across the Nile, and it will, and they're doing it because they have poverty, they want to use that water for irrigation. But for Egypt, it's their lifeline, and they have issued a warning that they will go to war if the dam is built. Now, whether you resolve this, that's...
Won't that happen in Israel and Palestine? Won't that happen in India and Pakistan? It'll happen all over the place. Is the bigger question climate change?
Yes.
Is it all joined together? But coming back to the original question, resolving it at the source, if people do not have hope and can see their lives improving, anybody offers them an alternative, they will take it. It is better than what they have.
Interesting, but yet, I mean, you could argue, you mentioned climate change, for example, and you look at the conflict in Darfur in Sudan, mm-hmm. where you had a settler community, and then you had the ranchers, the Janjaweed, coming, going north and south for generations. They've been traveling south with their herds and traveling north. And the problem was partly climate change, less and less grazing, too many herds, and the end result, whatever the rights and wrongs of it, was you had a militia that started to put down the local farmers, and the ranchers, the Janjaweed, who were coming back and forth, and they were armed. So climate change created a situation where there were limited resources, and then we had a war. I mean, terrible war, the Darfur conflict. I mean,
whether the money that is spent on that armament could be creating more dams, creating forests with a limited water supply that will create its own atmosphere. You are trying to, as tried in North Australia, create another climate by building a dam, growing vegetation. It worked to a certain extent, but nobody wanted to live there. Could something be, it's better than fighting.
And what about then, I mean, if we, I can see it's better than fighting, but I'm just thinking of specifics. I mean, take the Libyan war. We had we decided in the West that we would overthrow President Gaddafi. There was an uprising. There was a definite uprising, and it was a genuine uprising. It's part of the Arab Spring. People in Benghazi particularly led a revolution. We decided if things had been left to the natural course of events, they'd have been repressed, crushed. But we decided, no, we couldn't. We had to interfere, and we interfered by creating a no-fly zone, by support, and ultimately by bombing Gaddafi's forces as they approached Misrata.
Did the West, though, think further than just deposing him?
No, because Libya is in total chaos now, and Libya is an ongoing war zone.
The West never thought further than the first base. Mm. Had they thought about putting in the infrastructure rather than bombing it to pieces, as they did in Baghdad, there'd be an entirely different outcome now.
So, essentially, I mean, you believe that what? I mean, all of these conflicts, you look at the Arab Spring, and the way the Syrian uprising happened. There are many arguments as to what the initial cause was. Some say that it was the arrest of some boys in Deraa in southern Syria who'd been writing graffiti on the walls. Now, whether that is correct or incorrect, but whatever, an anti-government graffiti on the walls of buildings in Deraa. Whether that was the trigger for the Arab Spring uprising in Syria is debatable, but let's say that was the trigger. How do you get around that? Is education going to, you have a a government that feels threatened by, and then goes and arrests these. You're saying education will solve it?
Education and hope will, over a generation. The trouble is we only see, and our politicians only see, to the next general election. Mm. Or in the case of a dictatorship, the next election rigged.
Right, yes.
Yeah. And they won't broach any alternative ideas. So you can't do it overnight, but by wanting a population that is educated, they will question, and you cannot stop people thinking.
So, I mean, if you take this analogy, and if it is an analogy, I don't know how we should describe it, but essentially, if you take the parallel of the bigger conflicts, the Second World War, for example, the Second World War came about arguably because a fanatic emerged in Germany and seized the heart of the nation, and away to go. But these were an educated people.
We see him as a fanatic. The Germans didn't. They saw him as a savior.
But they were an educated people.
They were an educated people because they were repressed by the Kaiser and not allowed to develop. And there along Hitler came along and said, we have an answer. We will repress you. We will control you, but give you salvation.
Mm-hmm. So you... Well, perhaps the media plays a role, but at a basic level, you're saying that if their economic aspirations and so on had been met, then we wouldn't have seen the emergence of this.
Yes.
This dictator.
With the hyperinflation.
Yeah. So there are economic drivers for the collapse of society in the sense that the move towards war, and there are I guess social drivers, but you're saying that education is part of the remedy for this.
I believe so. Yeah. You educate your children so that they can question, they can fulfill their aspirations and dreams.
But so many of the wars are driven by, not all of them, but there's a significant number of the wars we see today are driven in part by our own disapproval. Iraq, for instance. We disapproved of the way Iraq was being run by a dictator whom, in the aftermath of 9/11, we became more aware of the fact that he had used chemical weapons against his own people and so on. We accused him of continuing to have chemical weapons, but he had, by and large, degraded and disposed of them. But we didn't accept that. And ultimately, we decided to go to war to liberate the people of Iraq from their dictator.
Was it the people of Iraq, or did Big Oil want control of the oil fields as it did in Iran?
Well, surely, yes, surely in the sense that if we're talking about ongoing war in countries like Sudan in Africa, I mean, we're not going to bother to interfere militarily, because actually, curious enough, Sudan now does have oil, but at the time the recent conflict began in Sudan, it didn't, so it wasn't a major issue for us. So you're right, oil economic issues are important, but nonetheless...
How many schools were left after the Allies bombed Baghdad and other towns and cities in Iraq?
Yes, but prior to the bombing, Iraq was
a reasonably secular society.
And a very well-educated society.
Yes. So the infrastructure was devastated.
Yeah.
And where do you start again? You don't. You've gone back from being able to take your children to school safely. You may have a dictator, but at least they could walk to and from school without being
But they attacked. Had education. We had education. Mm-hmm. How is education going to help stop that war?
Because there were bigger, there were outside influences that had their agendas. The British, the mm-hmm. Americans, and commercial interests as well.
So not in every case will
nothing will resolve all issues. It's always a combination of a number of them. But if we are educated, if we have the basic, what we classify as human rights, mm-hmm. The ability to question, the ability to go to school, whether boys and or girls, the freedom to walk around, to associate. Mm. If those are taken away, if one of those are taken away, it makes it more difficult for the others.
I kind of like Roosevelt's four freedoms: freedom from fear, freedom from want, freedom of expression, and freedom of religion. I've always...
Which country can attest to that one?
Well, yes. Well, we it's like saying you're a Christian or a Muslim. I mean, who can be a true perfect Muslim or a true perfect Christian? You can aspire to... just as you can aspire to freedom from fear and freedom of expression.
The tenets of all those monotheistic religions is loving thy brother and sister.
Mm, mm, yeah.
It's being able to accept them.
Yes, indeed.
I can remember coming back here a couple of years ago and going to a church service just up the road mm. where a woman rabbi gave
right.
the sermon.
Yes.
And she was almost empathetic to the German soldier. That mm. was very powerful, very moving.
Mm.
And I thought, for somebody, as a woman, a rabbi, to mention that and how awful it must have been for them,
mm.
I thought was really very powerful.
Yes, poignant. So, and the world is... Well, we could say the world is getting better. We've been through the 20th century, and in the 20th century, our grandparents fought in the West, certainly in the First World War, and indeed the Middle East, because the Middle East memories of the First World War raged right through the Middle East, and then our parents fought in the Second World War. And again, in the Middle East, that same war mm. was raging through North Africa. These were world wars in which multiple millions died in different ways, some through bombing, some through disease, some through death mm. camps or whatever. The 21st century is a better place, maybe. I mean, we're still seeing terrible wars. We still have the terrible Syrian war. We have the Yemen war emerging. But we haven't seen world wars. Are we learning? Are we moving towards a better world?
I don't think so. I think the drivers for the war are probably the same as what they were. Economic, big business, financial interests. Fundamentalism in the various religions, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Judaism, or whether it's Islam. Northern Ireland crisis was resolved after 300 years. Can the differences between the various religions ever be resolved without goodwill? But there are vested interests. There's financial. And there's economic vested interest. Why would manufacturers of armaments want peace?
Well, let's go to that subject, because that's the second subject on our agenda, isn't it, today? So, we've talked about the source of war, up to a point anyway. We haven't quite resolved it, but we have talked about it. Let's talk about the economic factors. Does the political establishment in Western countries favor waging wars for reasons other than those stated by their politicians? Conspiracy theorists suggest that vested interests, lobbies, pressure groups, and other webs of influence may have the ear of those in power and may be swaying policy, especially in matters of foreign relations. However, are there in fact genuine economic factors that drive us to war? The economic factors. What are the? I mean, let's talk about the arms industry. Is this? I suppose it is a driver towards war for the entire world. The desperate eagerness of the arms industry to sell weapons beyond and above the weapons people need. I mean, that would be a fact, wouldn't it?
Definitely, and governments like to keep people employed.
Yes.
And the armaments industry keep people employed. It's an easy solution. Build more weapons.
Mm.
Sell more weapons. Surreptitiously let other people take weapons.
Yes, yes. And it's interesting too. Just talking about Britain, we have a nuclear weapons system called Trident, which is run from a series of nuclear submarines, and there are always two at sea at any point in time, carrying these immensely powerful nuclear warheads on behalf of a British.
How can you see? Yeah, I cannot see any of the major nuclear powers ever wanting a conflict.
No.
The conflicts go underneath the radar, as it was explained in the paper the other day, the ant trail of weapons crossing Europe. One or two guns, a couple of explosives in a car, and hundreds of cars are doing it. Someone is supplying the weapons to the various armies, militias in Africa, in the Middle East, and in the Far East.
Well, supplying and buying. I mean, the cost of these weapons is astonishing.
Someone is supplying them.
Someone is supplying
hundreds of Toyotas to ISIL.
No, where we can identify. I mean, Turkey is supplying the Toyotas to ISIL. Britain is buying Trident from America. And, you know, we're talking here, if we're talking Trident, a weapon system that will never be used in any sane world, its cost is ranging from, I mean, its accumulated cost is approaching £60 billion. £60 billion. It's an incomprehensible sum, more than $120 billion.
Mm.
I mean, it is so astonishing that it beggars belief that will have been spent on this weapon system by the time it.
How much does that compare with the amount of research done by the Americans and the Russians and the French? And the Germans and the English in small arms, in drones, in other armaments, robots to kill people without having feet on the ground. That is more insidious because people from the other side will get hold of it and they will use it against us.
Yes.
And then we'll want even more. Where does it stop?
Well,
it stops by not producing them in the first, not allowing them to fall into the wrong hands.
Well, the proliferation of weapons is immense. I mean, the AK-47, the Kalashnikov, is the weapon of choice in many of these conflicts.
It's cheap as chips.
Yeah, absolutely. And there was, I don't know what the current cost, but there was a point shortly after the liberation of Iraq that you could buy a Kalashnikov in Baghdad for $18.
Iraq's been liberated.
Well, yes, there's a question too. But the or after the fall of Saddam, if you prefer, Iraq is actually always very choice about this. They will avoid saying the liberation of Iraq, and they will avoid saying the invasion of Iraq, because either will paint them in one corner or the other. So they always refer to the fall of Saddam. Let's get back to this issue of the economic drivers. We talked about weapons,
yes,
at least up to a point, and the arms industry being a promoter of war. There are other economic drivers behind war. I mean, people want to take power, seize power, or have an hegemony for oil is one. Mm. I mean, arguably, or at least it's a perception. I'm not sure how true it is. It's a perception that as we just referred to earlier in this discussion, we oil drove us into war with Iraq. It's certainly true that where there are major economic issues, we're more likely to go to war. Would that be the case?
The elected government of Iran was deposed by the oil barons to put in the Shah.
Right.
He was more friendly to be able to open up the Iranian oil fields to the American oil companies. Mm. Mm. It's probably happened elsewhere, and it's that driver. But the we did discuss it a bit earlier. Water is the next major area of conflict, and India and Bangladesh being sourced from water coming from Nepal and from
Pakistan.
Mm. Something's going to give, and Pakistan and India aren't best friends.
Well, let's come back to that then. I mean, in regard to
and Southeast Asia through Laos, Laos and Cambodia, the Mekong is being dammed all the way up through, and someone is going to miss out.
So, with regard to we referred to this, but the next potential war, the war between Egypt and Ethiopia over water, because Ethiopia is damming the Nile. Mm. What do you advise? What should be done?
Whatever needs to be done, it needs to be done now, and I think it's the beholden on the United Nations to actually get involved and not sit on the sidelines and wait till there's a conflict and then try and resolve it. Who knows what the answer is? I don't. But not doing anything is not the solution. The Sudanese have the Ethiopians have every right, I suppose, as in a sovereign nation, to dam the water that runs through them. But they also have responsibility to the Egyptians further on down.
Mm.
Can we not share?
Difficult to
Have we learnt to share?
But it's very difficult to share when you have a river, and you know, sharing means cutting the water to the people who've always had water running through their land. I mean, yet Ethiopia is impoverished.
But there is water that is plenty during the rainy season. Is there another way of damming that up and letting in the dry season the water run through?
That's an interesting point, actually, because yes, there are. I'm sure that might be a way forward. That's a very interesting point, and one that
there has to. We are intelligent human beings. We should be able to find an answer.
And yet, greed for water. Turkey has been so greedy for water that it has virtually, seriously stemmed the flow of the Tigris and the Euphrates. And if you're going to be that greedy for water, then there's no resolution of the issue, is there?
There has to be resolution. It's being able to openly talk about it, and for the organisation in power to relinquish some of it.
And then poverty itself is a driver for war. If you look at certainly driver for extremism, if you look at Gaza, for instance, I mean, Gaza in theory should be one of the wealthiest countries in the world because it has huge natural gas resources. But it's not because of, it's a question of what the chicken and the egg, but because of the Palestine-Israel conflict, it's not allowed to develop those natural gas resources, which are immense. There is talk of Egypt developing them on behalf of Palestine or Israel, but then Gaza will get very little of the income. So Gaza, which should be an immensely prosperous place, has, because of the political extremism in Gaza, is under lockdown by both Egypt and Israel. And understandably, you could say, it's governed by Hamas and so on. So, poverty drives rage, and then they throw rockets at Israel and do other things. Yes, so poverty is a driver for war. I mean, in that sense, at least it drives people to resentment, it drives people to extremism, and then the outcome can be uprising.
Someone shows them the potential way out by conflict, and they take it. Can you blame them?
No, absolutely.
If you have nothing and someone's going to offer you something by fighting, well, you go and do it for your kids.
I mean, family. We see. You're right. We see this in the Syrian refugee camps, where young men have no prospect of employment, and they see their families impoverished in the refugee camps in places like Turkey. And because they have no prospect, they have no future, no employment, nothing but a pittance and a handout, they go back to regain some dignity and fight for ISIS and get paid. I mean, have some money to send home. And you find that indeed of course there's international recruitment for ISIS, but the largest single number of people coming forward to fight for ISIS are refugees.
So why doesn't the British and the American and the French government and the German government say, oh, well, let us provide more assistance to the refugee camps in Syria, Turkey and Lebanon?
Yes, you would think.
Because that's far cheaper than spending £32 billion that Cameron wants to throw away on new armaments.
Yeah, easier to bomb, though, isn't it? I mean, at the end of the day, requires less thought, and we can...
Doesn't solve the problem.
No, true.
Resolving the problem at the source is our first question.
There are clearly vested interests in the world's mass media. The manner in which these are exploited and exploit, and in which populations at large may be convinced to go along with the opinions of vested interests, is the subject of our third topic. In the modern world, the media has too often fallen prey to becoming a mouthpiece for those in power. Will new forms of media, most especially new forms of social media, escape this trap? The media, where are we at? Is the media... Well, what's your take on the world's media today?
We only get to see basically one side, the one side that either the government in power or the media barons want us to see. There is an unholy alliance between both the print and the television media and various politicians or political parties. To feed us what they would like us to hear, and not the other side. Public radio, public television is not funded because it doesn't generate income and it doesn't generate political capital. Is that a conspiracy?
There is a kind of... I don't know about conspiracy, but I remember... headlines in the papers, even at the time of the Falklands War, driving war, sink the Belgrano. These kinds of headlines, Belgrano being a battleship that was standing against our forces in terms of the Falklands conflict. So you had these very aggressive headlines in the run-up to war with Saddam over Iraq, again very aggressive. What we call the red tops, the popular press in Britain, very aggressive, language coming out of them, saying...
Supporting the government's perspective.
Well, even leading the government, I would argue. The question is, to what degree is the media leading the campaign for war in so many of these instances, and the politicians following? They dance together.
And without banner headlines, they do not sell.
No.
And if they do not sell, they will not get income. So they have, as you probably quite rightly say, have to lead by being more outspoken.
Yes, yes.
Just listen to talkback radio. You listen to some of the shock jocks.
Yes.
All they want to do is say something controversial to get them in the newspapers.
And you have, I mean, you have extreme channels. I mean, that are Fox News in America, that are extremely pro-war, pro-aggressive approach. And you're right, we have different perspectives. I mean, you'll get one perspective from Al Jazeera, you'll get one perspective from Al Arabiya, you'll get one perspective from the BBC, one from Voice of America, and so on. Very often serving a self-serving agenda. I mean, Al Jazeera, whatever you think of Al Jazeera, has been very difficult in regard to Egypt, you know, in terms of its, and this is for historical reasons, because Al Jazeera is run by the Qatari government, the Egyptian government, a long time ago, supported a counter-revolution, if you like, against the, because the, against the Qatari emir, the Egyptian military, that is, supported the when there was a, I guess you'd call it a coup, I hate to use that word, but I mean, it's the simplest one, against his father. So the Egyptian tried to bring back his father. And there has been generational hatred between Qatar and Egypt ever since, even though it's never voiced. It's never voiced as that. But Al Jazeera becomes, even Al Jazeera, the great crusading channel, is partisan in its way. Every media outlet is flawed.
But how many Western countries openly embrace those channels? We don't, in New Zealand, we don't get BBC on free-to-air. We get Al Jazeera on free-to-air.
Yeah.
A lot of the existing media is privately owned. Even the government television and radio stations, well, television station has to make a profit. So it has to sell. It's not donated by license fees. So that has to provide one version of a popular media. The radio, again, if they don't follow the party line, maybe they get the funding gets reduced.
So in New Zealand, government radio has to sell advertising and government television? No.
Government radio doesn't sell advertising. But government TV does.
Interesting.
It has to survive.
Interesting. So the taxpayer doesn't do it. That's unusual, though, in terms of state television, isn't it? Usually it's funded by the state, which gives the state even greater control. But so much of this is self-censorship. So much of this is the journalists themselves censoring themselves, carrying the line they feel will please their masters.
I don't know in England, but definitely in New Zealand, the number of journalists is being cut dramatically. They're getting copy from news sources around the world. So that means that what we are hearing is being filtered by someone else, not by the New Zealand perspective.
Yes, yes.
And the option or the opportunity to hear alternative opinions is reduced because there are fewer and fewer real journalists. They're just copy typists or picking up news from foreign sources.
And then you have the columnists who are often xenophobic and you know, well, nationalistic, and inevitably. And that drives very severe sectarianism, hatred, and so on. I mean,
well, in New Zealand is one of the few countries that doesn't have quite the xenophobia that other countries do. Compared to Australia, where I lived in for 16 years, New Zealand has a very, very good human rights record, appreciation of its first settlers, and acceptance of different nationalities, religions, and perspectives.
Because Australia has huge racial tensions, and it's just staggering, isn't it?
Sad, really.
Yeah.
From a country that was settled 40,000 years ago, and then the migrants came 250 years ago, 200 years ago.
And we have huge tensions here in Europe, which migration, it's actually not fair to entirely blame the media, because migration, with this wave of both refugees and economic migrants from countries like Syria.
If the European Union supported the people in the camps, would they want to leave?
Well, actually, oddly enough, a lot of people will say yes, they would, but actually, I wonder whether they would leave in their numbers if conditions were not so atrocious for refugees. Because people,
what have they got to go back to in Syria?
That's right. People generally don't like to take the risk of leaving home and so on, if they have havens in their own countries of origin that they can.
If you wanted to cross London and the chances of you getting to the other side were slim, would you do it? Would you send your children?
Well, I'm not sure you would. Never mind slim. If there was a 1 in 10 risk that one of your children might die in the process, you would hesitate.
Yeah.
And it's a very dangerous path to take. Interesting. So,
but the media, I think from the media that I have seen in New Zealand, has been quite sympathetic to the waves of migrants crossing the Mediterranean and through Turkey and Greece.
Understandably. And yet there's half the picture because the proportion of those migrants who are genuine refugees as opposed to economic migrants, not small, but it's not, the majority are economic migrants. The majority are young men. And if you go to Baghdad, my own daughter is a journalist and she lives and works in Baghdad. And if you go to Baghdad, the queues to the Turkish Airways office go around the block of young men saying, this is our chance. And they're trying to get on flights to Istanbul and then in due course cross over to, understandably, I mean, so would I if I were in their position. But if you're talking about refugees, the media is, well, not exactly the problem, but it is a contributor. But the media is also, let's be fair, the media, we need the media. Yes. They give us, without the media, we'd have no news at all, and we wouldn't be complaining about it. We're on the media now, you know. So they can contribute to the problem, but they also contribute to the solution. Journalists actually have a moral responsibility. Ethical journalism is important, and they have a moral responsibility to convey the truth and all aspects of the truth.
Would you like to see the media in the hands of more people as opposed to in the hands of a few?
I would like to see...
Divide and rule, sort of?
Do you know what we're not seeing? In terms of the Western newspapers, there is too much economic need to make a profit today. And they're looked at too much as businesses. In the days of the old press barons, and I'm talking about my father and my grandfather's days, profit was a motive, and selling newspapers was a motive, but these press barons also felt that they wanted to crusade for a better world. They had a vision. And it wasn't primary. I don't think in most instances of these great names, Beaverbrook, Northcliffe, the great press barons, I don't think their prime driving motive was profit. There was much more money to spend on investigative journalism. And it's very hard now for teams to do this kind of work.
We've been talking about the Western media. What about the media in Egypt, in Tunisia, in Algeria, in Israel, in Iraq and Iran and Syria? That's just a one-man band, surely.
Well, there's less free press. The problem is that you need a license to open a paper or a television station from the government, and there are
you
problems.
You do here as well. Maybe the West could be a little bit more enthusiastic in asking or coercing in one way or another for another opposition press.
Yes, I would like to see more. I think we should encourage opposition.
Not opposition, but alternative, I think is a better word.
Well, alternative press, yes, in all of these situations. There isn't enough of it. There are few countries in the Middle East that have fair press. Kuwait, Lebanon, maybe. But very few. Kuwait, Lebanon, Israel, I guess. Palestine, oddly, up to a point. But they are few. There are a few countries with any opposition press. Bahrain has an opposition newspaper, whatever its other problems, but it does, which is rare in the GCC states. I did say Kuwait did, but most of the other Gulf states to have an opposition paper is unusual. So
Pakistan has opposition newspapers.
Pakistan does indeed, but there, at a price, we kept records of the death toll amongst journalists, assassination of journalists, at one stage, and of course it's atrocious in the Middle East and in conflicts like Syria, citizen journalists are constantly killed. Individuals that take it upon themselves to write columns or to report by blogging or Facebook or whatever. These citizen journalists are endlessly killed. In places like Gaza, journalists are killed very often because they'll be going to the fighting. They'll be going to the area of worst fighting to report.
Collateral damage.
And yes, they become collateral damage. But in a country like Pakistan, the death rate of journalists through assassination dwarfs almost any other nation. It's staggering.
It's certainly not well known in the New Zealand press. We just don't hear about it.
No, they have a terrible time. And it's if you are, and not necessarily by the government or ISI or whatever it might be, it's very often...
Vigilante groups?
Well, yes, vigilante groups. Yeah, and good old Al-Qaeda, the like, these what we would call terrorist groups. If somebody tries to report fair and square in the Northwest Territories, they get assassinated by these extremists.
Do you see the internet being a valuable channel then for alternative viewpoints, because you can do it almost anonymously?
Yes, I think so. I think it's the salvation of the world.
Mm. In one way, and then of course you get the others recruiting.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. It's a platform for extremism, but it also means that the younger generation who are on Facebook, on Twitter, and so forth, and on the other platforms, they know one another across boundaries, across cultures. I do think I see a better world coming and a safer world. Mm-hmm. And yes, the modern media, Twitter, Facebook, the social media, may save us. I hope so.
Well, let's hope so too.
Well, on that note,
I think we've had most of our days.
Yes.
And we have to leave it for the next generation and believe in them.
Well, I think that's right. Thank you, Christopher. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Will,
for
being our guest on ANN Television. Many thanks. it's such a subject, isn't it? We've given ourselves a lot of ground to cover. But the causes of war, the root causes of war, are they economic? I think up to a point they are. Certainly social conditions and deprivation drives people to extremism and fundamentalism and radicalism. So yes, economic issues are a factor. They are a factor in another sense. Clearly, it's sadly true that the Western arms industry, which fuels much of these wars, is, well, it's a major factor in promoting war. It has to be, it is, and it continues to be. And look at the billions and billions and billions and billions of dollars that are wasted when we could be helping refugees, we could be helping those in deprivation, the hungry, the sick, the vulnerable, the very old, the very young. But we choose weapons, we choose war as our immediate response. And it's sad to say that in Syria and in Iraq today, the first resource is to bombing. And only subsequently do we look at political measures and other measures that would perhaps move things forward. And we need them. We need the political measures. We need the de-Ba'athification laws removed in Iraq. We need political steps taken. We need Turkey to stop supporting ISIS. We need the closure of the northern border of Syria to troublemakers, really. And so we need to think about measures that will change the way things are. And then the media. What to say about the media? The media is it helping promote war? We've so often seen headlines here in the Western press which are, well, they are thumping on and thumping on about the need for war, the need for violence, the need for retribution. And too often when we talk of justice, we are talking of retribution, of paying back those that have hurt us. And xenophobia, hatred of the other, this is so much a cause, well, caused by the media, a cause of war caused by the media. Does the media lead our politicians to war, or do our politicians lead the media? I'm not so sure that the media has a grave responsibility for the move towards war in the world today. And governments, well, governments are served by the media. There is a kind of self-censorship sometimes by journalists who wish to please their masters. And when there isn't, there's repression often from governments who insist on journalists pleasing their masters. Whatever the case, the media today really needs to take very seriously, and does, I think, take very seriously its responsibility. But it needs to continually self-examine its motives and the way it behaves. It is a troubling world. The media does have the power to promote peace, not in some evangelistic way, but by not espousing violence and by creating better understanding. There is a role for peace through media. So God grant we may see a better and safer media in the world today.